Ladies and gentlemen, hello and welcome to On the Radar, presented by Pakistan Geostrategic Review in association with the Center for Strategic and Contemporary Research. I'm your host, Zaki Khalid.
And this is Talal Ibrahim.
Our featured guest for this episode is Kashun Liza. Kashun is an Islamabad-based analyst as well as a teacher and research associate at the School of Politics and International Relations in Qaid-e-Azam University. Her research interests include conflict studies, Pakistan's foreign policy, the Indo-Pacific, international law, women's empowerment, and minority issues. We invited Kashun in lieu of a recent article by her that was published in South Asian Voices, an online policy platform hosted by the US-based Stimson Center. In her article, Can CPEC Help Pakistan Revive Its Vision East Asia Policy? Kashun tries to examine in detail the hindrances behind Pakistan's economic diplomacy in Southeast and East Asia. She explains how Islamabad can expand on its economic horizon, and she also advocates for a revitalized approach to the region. It's a pleasure to have Kashun with us in this episode. Welcome to the program, Kashun.
Thank you, Zaki and Taha, for inviting me. The context of this article, that is, can China-Pakistan Economic Corridor help Pakistan revive its Vision East Asia policy? The context was that the Indo-Pacific, Asia-Pacific region at large is becoming the center of international politics. And we've been seeing that for quite a time over. And with that, we need the idea behind this article was that Pakistan needs to initiate a national narrative for engagement in the region. And I try to initiate a debate concerning that, and I try to give a blueprint on how Pakistan could engage in the region, and what could be Pakistan's posture. It could be economic, it could be strategic, and I highlight the economic and strategic part.
So, Ms. Liza, you have cautioned that the geopolitics of ASEAN should not constrict the potential economic gains of Pakistan. Being a strategic partner of China, how well, in your belief, Pakistan can not tow or refrain from towing the Chinese line on South China Sea when building trade and economic linkages with other ASEAN countries?
Talha, you have pointed out an excellent point, and that's exactly like what you're saying is exactly my point in the article. I can reiterate, I write that there's the littoral states in South China Sea in the Asian region, the Asian nations, they are arrayed against China, against its territorial disputes, against its maritime position. But I argue that that should not stop Pakistan from engaging economically with the region. And I don't think that should pose any hindrance to Pakistan, because I argue in the later part of my section that Pakistan should pursue creative diplomacy. And in that section, I write that the ASEAN nations themselves have a credible economic relationship with China. For example, the bilateral trade volume between ASEAN nations and China is around $644 billion. So why should Pakistan, step back from having economic relationship with ASEAN nations when China itself and these ASEAN nations themselves are having a good economic relationship? And also, while writing this article, I went through a study which showed that China is one of the arms exporter to ASEAN nations. So while these two nations are engaged in a direct conflict with one another, they are also engaged in arms exports, arms imports. Pakistan, that is on the periphery of this conflict, is not even directly engaged. So why should we not pursue our economic interest? And also, something that you could sense from my article is that we need economic engagement with this region. We cannot engage on strategic issues with ASEAN if we do not have economic interactions with them. We have seen that in the last year, that the lack of economic interactions with various nations costed us a lot on various issues, and I don't need to mention them one by one. We all know that. So Also, on the official level, we have this policy that we are going to advocate economic diplomacy at the official level. So with that on the horizon, I think the situation and the context is perfect for Pakistan to pursue economic diplomacy. And engagement with China, strategic engagement with China, should not hold us back. And it will not hold us back.
Right. So my question, Kashun, for you is, that you mentioned about Southeast and East Asian nations, we shouldn't just confine ourselves to the strategic angle or the economic angle, but you are actually more strongly proposing that the economic angle itself, that there should be more increased trade with ASEAN countries and Japan. But my question to you over here is, after having read your article, that we all know Southeast and East Asian countries have a unique socio-cultural makeup, which is shaped by a broader maritime heritage. Pakistan, well, you know, has traditionally been a land-centric country. We don't have that sort of a maritime culture with which we could, try to establish some links with these ASEAN countries and Japan. So how potent do you think economic diplomacy could be in the absence of a robust cultural exchange framework? Do you think that is necessary before you can establish any sort of meaningful economic links?
Yeah. So you see, Zaki, the thing about cultural exchange is that you don't need to have a universal culture for it. So the idea of having a cultural exchange is that you take a cultural aspect from their side and you give a cultural aspect from your side. And that's the beauty of engaging with different cultures. So you learn something from them, they learn something from you. So if Pakistan do not have a established or more pronounced maritime culture, there's no harm in learning that from the Southeast Asian countries, right? Also, the Southeast, you rightly point out that these Asian nations and also the East Asian nations have a maritime culture. They have a collective history, which is why ASEAN is developed as a regional organization, more so than the SAARC, while we also have regional collective historical and cultural linkages, but they are doing better than us. But the point again is that while I also want to point this out, that I do believe that this gives India an edge over us. India shares this maritime culture to an extent, while it's not exactly the same, but also if we look in the historical linkages, we saw that there was a Indianization going on. In fact, this is one of the book by Arik Regmar. He's a Turkish author. He writes a non-European perspective on the international relations history. And he writes that India, there was a process called Indianization when culture was expanded from India, the subcontinent, to I retrace subcontinent because at that time there was no partition. So from the subcontinent, the culture is expanded to the Southeast Asian region. So there's a lot of interaction going on in the history. In all of these regions, you have Chinese voyages coming in to the Indo-Pacific. You have Indians going out to the voyage in Southeast Asia. And so while we do not have a very credible history of Pakistan having engagement with the Southeast Asian regions, we do have a credible history of subcontinent engaging with Southeast Asia region, right? And at that time, there was no partition. So India and Pakistan was one. So I do think that we can, I'm not an expert on history, so I cannot really give a comment on that, but we
that
can.
That Indianization aspect, I'm sorry to interject, that Indianization aspect which you're referring to, are you talking in the context of the Project Sagarmala, the shared cultural heritage, or is that something in a more broader sense?
It's in a more broader sense. It also incorporates the religious linkages. There's a linkage between the Southeast Asian nations and India. For example, Buddhism and all other religions, they expanded from India to these regions. That's what I read. I mean, I'm quoting Arik Regmar from non-European perspective on international relations.
Interestingly, I was reading this article last night written by C. Raja Mohan, and he has made somewhat similar argument about the regional primacy that was there during pre-independence time, when this was one region, the subcontinent was undivided. and it somewhat echoes your what you have just said. Now, my next question from you is I want to know your point, I want to get an understanding from you about because your core argument is that Pakistan should make economic linkages with other East Asian countries under CPEC. So Pakistan tried to do the same with Saudi Arabia earlier this year. We issued this statement that Saudi Arabia is interested in opening a refinery, an oil refinery in Gawadar. And we made some statement that we are partnering with Saudi Arabia in CPEC projects. So there was some confusion when this statement came from a very responsible person, the petroleum minister in the cabinet. So how do you think China will react over Pakistan's similar economic foray towards East Asian countries under CPEC? Will we see a repeat of the same situation, or will the situation be different?
I think you have pointed out an excellent counter argument. And in fact, I write that argument while discussing the concerns over CPAC. In my previous article, which was published in May, that Pakistan should diversify its foreign its economic relationships, while I write that there are concerns over CPAC, and I write this as one of the concerns. But however, answering your questions, I don't think that China will raise any concerns over Pakistan having economic or expanding its economic engagement with Western Pacific region under the broader CPAC umbrella. Why do I think that? Because BRI, CPAC is a flagship project of BRI, and BRI is a regional connectivity project, right? So a regional and what I'm arguing is that CPAC, it helps Pakistan advance its regional connectivity pursuits. So while Pakistan, for example, one of the points that I make in this article is that Pakistan should have a trade via the Chinese northeast and western ports, and that allows Pakistan to have to basically access the Asian tiger markets through a less transit time and lower cost, and that's a shorter land route, for example, from Gwadar to Kashgar and Kashgar to any northwestern ports, which could be a Qingdao port or the Shanghai port, and that's a regional connectivity project, right? So I don't think that there should be any concern, because it adds to the Chinese BRI pursuits, that is regional connectivity. And CPAC is at the hub of this regional connectivity project. So it's a flagship project. So if CPAC is adding to the regional connectivity pursuits, it should not bother China, and it will not bother China, because China is, and also, I'll take this opportunity to reiterate one of my arguments that I make in this article, is that CPAC is viewed extensively through the lens that it allows China's access to the Indian Ocean, but it's not it's not studied vice versa. How could CPAC enhance Pakistan's access to the East, to the Eastern nations? That could be East Asia, that could be Southeast Asian countries. And it does so. So, you know, it's not going one way. It's going both ways. So if Pakistan is helping China to increase its regional connectivity pursuits with the West, so CPAC is meanwhile again helping Pakistan to increase its regional connectivity pursuits with its East. So it's serving the whole broader perspective, that is regional connectivity.
My question to you, carrying forward from this very elaborate answer of yours, Kashun, is that you talked about Pakistan, if it makes efforts into this ASEAN region and the Western Pacific side, then it will actually complement Beijing's own infrastructural ambitions over there. So it would be a win-win sort of thing, which is a very favorite term of China. But if we actually look into the overall connectivity framework being laid out by China, you see, as far as the Bay of Bengal and the Pacific Ocean is concerned, China has limited itself to Myanmar. We have the port, which obviously is going to be a sort of a political risk for Pakistan because of the ethnic issue going on over there. And we have to look into that broader spectrum. And then The only other project, which is quite a flagship project, is the, it's a very slow project, but it's the Melaka Gateway project in Malaysia, which China has been trying to make considerable investments in. But apart from that, the overall BRI map shows that China is actually, like Japan, it's looking west. China has made more infrastructure investments in West Asia, in Africa, and, you know, in the ports of Europe. So are we not maybe going into different directions? And as I mentioned about the point of Myanmar, I'm sorry to sound a bit specific over here, but that is the point of convergence where Japan and India also, they are looking west into the Asia-Africa growth corridor. So they are also moving west. And we want to go into that place, which is highly contested. You mentioned in your article that it's a very, it's a zone, the Asia-Pacific theater is a contested zone. So as from a business perspective, you're talking about Pakistani businessmen. What sort of risks are involved? Would they actually be willing, the business community over here, to venture into that contested zone and that overall scheme of, you know, China not being, not having that much of a framework over there? So this is quite a big question, and please take your time in answering it.
I will answer it point by point. One, you point out that the concern over how Pakistan could engage with Myanmar, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that the point for Pakistan is to establish economic strategic relations with these countries and not to engage or kind of interfere in the domestic politics of what's going on there, right? So Myanmar is a very contested, it's a very difficult country in that sense, if I may say so, because there's a lot of contestations going on there, and China rightly wants to access the deep ports through it. And there are a lot of concerns over it. There's military dictatorship, and there's Thailand is involved in it. India is involved in it. I mean, you have regional actors being involved in it. But for Pakistan, we first need to establish economic relationships. I reiterate that again. We need to establish economic relationships and not interfere into domestic politics of another state. So that's one thing, right? You point out that China and other regional actors in East Asia and Southeast Asia, they're going west while we are going east. And are we going in the wrong direction? I say no. We are going in the right direction, because as I mentioned in the introduction, that what is the context of writing this article was that Asia-Pacific, as I also write in my article and you point out, it's becoming a theater of strategic competition. You had Germany just, you know, jumping into the theater in September. So there's Germany and there's the France is already inside. I mean, Australia has signed a defense deal with India. So there's a lot going on, and every day, I mean, it's rapidly, international politics is, like, as we point out, it's in a flux. It's rapidly changing, and Pakistan needs to concentrate its effort, or maybe, you know, or divert its attention towards that side. And I don't think that looking east is anything unusual or new, because India already has its look east policy. It has moved on to act east policy, right? And we don't want to, you know, measure our steps vis-a-vis India. We have our own policy, we have our own posture, and we need to follow that.
Let me add to the previous statement you mentioned. You see, in your article, you made this very pertinent point that the maritime dispute in the Bay of Bengal and Western Pacific is actually creating misunderstandings between Beijing and ASEAN nations, right? So you have that thing over there. And now, in the same article, you mentioned that if Pakistan in that environment, it tries to, you know, use the BRI banner and try to make inroads into the region, the reception over there might not be as productive as one would expect. So are you suggesting, I'd like to know this from you, whether or not you're suggesting that Pakistan will have to go it alone and not associate itself with any Chinese project to make a credible foothold over there?
So again, I'll go by point by point. as you mentioned first, that there's a misunderstanding between the ASEAN and China and ASEAN nations over South China Sea dispute. It has gone beyond misunderstanding. It's a hot dispute right now. You know, even during the pandemic, you had, China having direct standoffs with naval standoffs with a number of nations. So it has gone beyond being a misunderstanding into being a hot dispute, active dispute in the South East Asia region, that is the South China Sea. I think I need to clear that I do not point out in my article that Pakistan needs to go into the Western Pacific with a BRI banner. And that's exactly what I point out in my constraints, that Pakistan needs to, there's a free and open Indo-Pacific concept that also very active in that region. So, and while Pakistan has the strategic engagement with China, it might, it might be a constraint for China on how for Pakistan on how it can engage with the free and open Indo-Pacific concept. But then again, I reiterate that be it BRI, be it free and open Indo-Pacific concept, Pakistan should not restrict itself to these only, like to these projects. For example, there's a Blue Dot Network going on, which is basically Australia, Japan, this is basically a project under them, which is subtly positioned against BRI. But that's not our concern, because what we need to do is highlight or keep in focus our own national interest. So if China engages in the region with any nation howsoever, that's not our concern, because we need to point out our own national interest, right? So there's a Blue Dot, coming back to my point, there's a Blue Dot Network, there's a Pacific setup. A Blue Dot Network is also a regional connectivity project. There's interconnection. That's basically the highlights of these projects are mainly now, these days, they're in Papua New Guinea. And also there's a Blue Dot Network that's funded by Australia. That's a local government development training programs and programs like these. So Pakistan could also, benefit from these programs. So we should not just stick ourselves to the BRI projects, but also expand our options. And by expanding our options, I mean engaging with Japan in the free and open Indo-Pacific concept, with the Blue Dot, with the Pacific Step Up, or also we could, create our own project, a project of our own, because Pakistan is creative enough to create a project of our own. And the reason I point out the CPAC element is this in this article is only in concerns of connectivity. How could CPEC help Pakistan, or give Pakistan a pull up to have a deeper engagement with that region? That does not mean that Pakistan has to engage with that region in the sphere of CPEC BRI only.
Right. So my last question to you is that once again, I'm trying to understand the fact that without any sort of, we have been focused more on the West Asia, the Middle East, and now our Foreign Office has been particularly focused on Look Africa policy. Because I think what they've understood very well is that all these great economic actors are, making inroads into Africa and all. Mm-hmm. So while the point which you're trying to reiterate, while it's very ambitious indeed, and it's very pertinent, for Pakistan to expand its economic horizon, which is the crux of your article. But how are you going to, once again, I have to ask this question, that from a purely business perspective, how are you going to motivate Pakistan to establish better ties when, for example, last year we had the KL summit, which proved to be a diplomatic disaster in the making, that actually risked our relations with countries such as Malaysia, which is an important a member of the Western Pacific. So how is Pakistan supposed to maneuver or navigate in the region without any sort of a great actor's guidance? How is that going to happen? What will push the system to focus on that part of the world?
I just have to ask, you mentioned without great power guidance, right? What do you mean by that?
By that, I mean that first we were navigating Asia's dynamics under the patronage of the US, and now we have the Chinese influence, which actually has a lot of influence on our maneuverings in the foreign policy spheres. So considering the dynamics going on in Pakistan, which will try its best not to give any sort of impression that it is party to any of the major actors in the Asia-Pacific theater, how will it navigate about? How will it navigate about and chart its own course? Do we have that sort of systemic arrangement in place to focus on Southeast and East Asia?
So one, as you point out, that there's a looked Africa policy going on. And I think also, I'll take this opportunity, while this is not part of my article, but I'll take this opportunity to say that this is also pertinent. Because, I mean, I will quote Robert Kaplan here in his book, Indian Ocean and the Future of American Power. He points out how there's China is it, India also is it, India is advancing its way into Africa in juxtaposition to China's own pursuits. And also he points out that one third of China's energy needs, you know, are coming from Africa, while one fifth of energy imports of India are coming from that region.
Yes.
So while you have your regional actors actively engaging into regions around, which are quite important region. Indo-Pacific is a very important region for Pakistan. Pakistan also needs to engage. I mean, there's no time to think and deliberate, but to engage right now. Also, as you point out, that the second thing that you pointed out was that there was a KL summit and there was an issue. And how could Pakistan businessmen establish, you know, what could motivate the Pakistani businessmen? So the clear cut, what do you call it? The rule of the business is it's a cutthroat business, right? And the rule of the business is benefit, benefit, benefit. Wherever you get benefit, so you're going there, and Pakistani businessmen are getting the benefit. So we are going to amplify our exports to these regions. So if we are going to amplify our exports, it's only going to benefit the Pakistani businessmen. Or even if the ASEAN states are coming into the Pakistan, as I point out in my article, that Thailand is intent to sign a free trade agreement with Pakistan. It's actually pushing Pakistan to sign a free trade agreement with it, because it identifies it as a significant partner. Also, it sees it as a major importer of the seafood and the raw materials. Also, there's an interest in Singapore, on the side of Singapore, their interest on Malaysian side in terms of arms exports. So, I mean, I just see interest. So,
ironically, in your article, you mentioned that the Pakistani Ministry of Commerce, they expressed their concerns that what they perceive as an Indian design to limit their influence and their interaction with ASEAN. So, but here you have what you've just mentioned, that Thailand is insisting that Pakistan should improve its cooperation. So how long are we going to, manifest our policy, the Vision East Asia policy, in a way which is more straightforward, it is robust, and it is not hampered by these concerns about some schemes taking place against us? Or because obviously it is in the interests of our rivals, of geopolitical rivals, to try to limit our influence. So how will we have to keep our focus on our own goals and not look at these small hindrances?
While we can put blinders on, but we can just not deny the fact that there are going to be constraints. And especially given that you have regional competitors, you have actors that do not want you to pursue or have deeper economic interaction. So we cannot just deny the fact that there's not going to be any hindrance while we go on our path. There are going to be numerous hindrances, as I point out, that the Pakistani, the Ministry of Commerce and Textiles cited Indian influence as the reason for Singapore blocking Pakistan ingress into the organization. I mean, that's one hindrance. There could be numerous hindrances coming up, and we just can't deny them. We have to navigate our way through them, and that, again, I reiterate, that is economic.
That's a very good point.
Also, moving back to your questions, you pointed out that there was a KL summit in Pakistan. There were unfortunate circumstances, and yes, I do point out that that was unfortunate for Pakistan to not join it, but even our prime minister, made a point that he when he visited Malaysia, he made a point for that. But I think the dynamics are changing. So when I say that the international politics is in flux, it's rapidly changing. It's obvious that confusions and assumptions and speculations are going to come up. And that's a speculation that came up about Pakistan, that Pakistan is choosing camps. So are we really choosing camps? No, we are not. So we are not choosing camps. So there's a clear messaging on our by our high officials that Pakistan is not going to choose camps. It's not Cold War era anymore. And even if it comes, if that era comes again, we are not going to choose camps anyway. We are going to go by our own national interest. And I think that should be the way. Moving on to your next question on how could Pakistan navigate into the region without great power guidance, I think Pakistan do not need great power guidance. Pakistan is mature enough to follow its own national interest. But there's also, meanwhile, I also point out that this great power competition cannot be denied in this region. It's only going to intensify in the years to come, because I point out that Western Asia Pacific is going to become a hotspot for international politics in the years to come. So the great power competition is only going to intensify. But do we need a great power guidance to navigate into the region? No, we do not. If we need, as I write my article, I did not articulate any need for a great power guidance, because we have economic relationships. We have good relationships with these nations. We just need to expand them. We just need to make them more better, right? So there are also going to be numerous constraints that are going to come forward under the broader aspect of great power competition that I point out, for example, South China Sea dispute, India versus Pakistan, and that's going to only intensify in the years to come. But that should never stop us from expanding and or developing deeper economic integration with the region.
So I'm assuming, please correct me, Talha, if my overall conclusion from Kashun's talk is incorrect. What I've understood and what I believe Kashun has tried to say over here is that Pakistan needs to be independent, it needs to be out there, and it needs to be persistent. There will be efforts to curtail us. Yes, there will be some strategic or economic hindrances along the way, but the persistence, I think, is the keyword over here, and the will to move forward into an economic strategic approach. Talha, do you have something to say on this?
Okay, so very interestingly, she said that we need to engage. You talked about whether there is a system in place. She said that we need to engage. It took India 24 years to go from look east to act east. So they set up those systemic, they set up those structures in place so that they can have a more proactive engagement when Prime Minister Modi came into power back in 2014. So it was a very interesting discussion, and we need to be more persistent, we need to be more proactive. You already have bilateral relations in place. We need to make it more, we need to go more into multilateral arrangement with other ASEAN countries. I really enjoyed this conversation.
So did I, likewise. And I'd just like to add over here a personal note of our thanks to Kashun Liza for joining us. And it is a pleasure to have her over here. And the fact that she is one of the very few research scholars we have here in Pakistan as far as the emerging scholars field is concerned, who are studying the Asia-Pacific/Indo-Pacific region and looking into the overall multi-dimensional aspects of it beyond just the strategic aspects or just the economic aspects in isolation. So Kashun, once again, thank you for joining us in this program. Your piece was excellent. It was wonderful to read. That is why you were on the radar, and that is why we invited you to this program. keep writing, and we look forward to more discussions with you in the future. For the audience, I'd just like to point out that you're welcome to visit the description of this YouTube video. You'll find a link to Kashun's article on South Asia Voices, where you can read her perspective in detail. With that, Talha and I would like to conclude this session. Goodbye.
Thank you.